Hey everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel. I'm here today doing a restorative practice, which we haven't done in a little bit. And I'm doing this one for my mom and then also for three clients who I see either for Reiki or yoga who are having issues with back pain. And I think for everybody, it's just really good to have these nice restorative practices to break up some of the athletic things we do and some of the stresses we put on our body. So for the flow today, you're going to need a chair, or we can use a wall if that's preferable, but if you're suffering from low back pain at all, a chair is going to be better. Doesn't have to be any kind of special chair, it could be a kitchen chair if you'd like. And then I'm going to drop the link in the description box on how to fold and prep blankets, but you will need a bolster or a self-created bolster from blankets. And then in addition to that, three other blankets. And for right now, I've got two of those eight fold lengthwise and one of those eight fold in a square. And then I also have just a little pillow for Savasana if you'd like to use that, and two blocks. And then the other optional thing is just a little eye pillow for Savasana because that can be a little bit relaxing. So I want to start in supported child's pose. And to prep for that, you're going to either use one or two bolsters, or you can use a bolster and two blocks, whatever it takes to get you in a posture that is not straining. And that's the key for all of these postures is you shouldn't be efforting at all. These need to be restorative and relaxing. And so if it's making you feel tense or if at any point you feel pain, modify the pose or do something else that feels right to you. So just to start, I'm going to take a deep breath in through your nose. Blow it out. Take one more breath in through your nose. And sigh it out. Let's get set up for child's pose. So for this, I'm going to take both of my blocks and I'm going to stack them. Just kind of, close-ish. And then I'm going to take my bolster because I have one. And I'm going to lay that right on top of my blocks. And then on your knees, you're going to scoot just as close as you can to that so that your bolster is sort of almost like on your lap at your hip creases. And then you're just going to fold over that, placing one cheek on the side, and let your arms rest down by your side. Now we're going to stay in this posture for somewhere between 5 and 10 minutes, and I'll tell you and cue you when you need to switch sides. For you, at any point in this practice, you're welcome to open or close your eyes. It's totally normal to fall asleep in a restorative yoga pose. And that's fine too. So if you'll close your eyes to begin the practice, I want you to imagine that there's a steep hill in front of you, whatever steep is to you. And on your back, you have a really heavy backpack. Could be like a backpacking adventure pack, you know, full of all your supplies. It could be whatever you imagine when you think of carrying something heavy on your back. And what is in that pack is actually burdens. They could be yours or they could be someone else's. They could be traumas, unresolved issues, all the way back to childhood. Worries about the future, doubts about yourself, doubts about your safety, doubts that everything will work out okay, anything you're afraid of. And that's what makes it so heavy, right? It's full of heavy things. And you're trudging your way up this hill. And you kind of feel really like you can't go on. Your back hurts, right? You're tired. And now I just want you, in your mind, with your eyes still closed, to look around and realize that maybe you thought you were at the base of that hill, but you were actually really close to the top of that hill, and now you are at the top of the hill. And the top of the hill is your destination. And you look around and you realize that the sun is shining, the sky is blue, maybe you hear birds chirping or little creatures rustling in the bush. And you realize you can put the backpack down anytime you want. And so I want you in your mind's eye to shrug your shoulders and let the backpack fall to the ground. And feel the relief and the release in your back. Maybe it's across your low back because you need to just support yourself with those muscles. Maybe it's on your upper back and your shoulders because it was weighing down on you. But with the pack gone, feel how light you are. Almost weightless now. Feel how much easier you can breathe in through your nose and out through your nose. And I want you to take a deep breath in through your nose, breathing in the mountain air, and sigh it out, releasing with it any remaining burdens that you may be feeling. At this time, you can turn your face to the opposite side to kind of level out your back. Keeping your eyes closed, breathing easily now that you've let all those burdens go. Feeling a nice deep release all the way up and down your back, across your shoulders. Feeling the safety that you have in this moment with the bolster supporting your heart and your mat or the floor supporting your feet and your knees. Breathing easier now, feeling free, and knowing that when you walk back down, that backpack doesn't have anything in it that you need. And you can just leave it there. And in your mind, you can take as long as you would like at the top of the mountain to enjoy the view. Enjoy what you can see after that long struggle. Knowing that the way down is very easy and is accessible to you at any time. And when you're ready, you can walk back down the hill, taking as long as you like. Maybe stopping to take pictures of flowers or notice something in nature that you didn't notice on the way up because the burden was so heavy. Maybe you see a hawk or an eagle fly overhead. You hear birds chirping that you didn't hear before. You notice the bees pollinating the flowers and butterflies fluttering by. And you easily walk back down the hill that actually isn't as steep as you thought it was. The climb down is easy, and at the base of the hill, you just smile to yourself and know that you are now lighter, that you are pain-free, that you are safe, and that you don't need to think about the past or the climb up the hill. Because that's over, you can make peace with it, but you don't live there. And you don't need to worry about the future because you don't know what's gonna happen anyway. There's no need to fear the unknown. You're safe now, and you will be safe then. But focus your attention on the fact that in this moment, you are safe, you're comfortable, you're supported. Take a deep breath in through your nose, sigh it out. Take just another moment in this posture. I'm going to turn my head to the other side for that last minute. When you're ready, you can press your hands into the ground on either side of your bolster and gently come back up. We're going to move our bolster to the side. And we're going at this, and also our block. So I'm going to move to the side. And at this time, you can use a pillow if you'd like underneath your head, but we're going to take legs on a chair. And we're actually, it's a little bit easier on your back if we just do one at a time. So we're just going to scoot our bottom pretty close to the chair and off to the side. And that way, my one leg is straight beside the chair, and my other leg is bent to a 90 degree angle, so basically I want my hip under my knee, and my knee supported on the chair, and I'm going to lie back. I have this pillow here. You can cover yourself over with a blanket, you can use a pillow. I'm just kind of letting this leg that's not on the chair, fall open, just be totally relaxed. You can place your hands on your heart if you'd like to, or you can place your hands open to your side, just kind of splayed out like you would for Savasana. Again, if you'd like to use the eye pillow to cover your eyes, and your lights should definitely be dim, maybe even candlelight, but if you want to block out any remaining light, you can put an eye pillow or something over your eyes and just let yourself melt into your mat. And I want you to notice how the mat and the floor are supporting your low back, your upper back under your shoulders. And let that pressure from the floor sort of act like a little self-massage almost, where it's putting pressure up onto your low back, relieving any pain that you feel, having this leg up to really kind of decrease that tension on the low back. And just breathe naturally here. While you're in these postures, which are longer holds than what we would do in a vinyasa class, try not to latch on to any particular thought. Imagine your thoughts as if they were clouds, the sky is blue above you, but those thoughts sort of drift by just as quickly as clouds might on a somewhat windy day. None of them stay too long. You can look at them, you can observe them, but you don't need to hold on to them. Just let them float by. Take notice of the air moving in and out of your nose. Feel your arms at your side or across your chest, or in my case, I have them right. Solar plexus, all are fine. Notice yourself being warm and comfortable. If you have a pillow underneath your head, maybe notice how soft that feels compared to the floor that's kind of hard. And the other thing about your thoughts is let's just not place any judgment on them. There's no right or wrong, no good or bad. They are just thoughts. And we can observe them and look at them as if they were objects. As you lie here, the one thing that one of my clients said to me is really all I can think about is how bad my back hurts. focus on. You know, pain can be such an overriding factor for us, and when things aren't functioning as we'd like them to, that can create a lot of anxiety and it can create a lot of focus. But what I would like you to do at any point that you, if you feel pain in a pose, for what, first of all, again, get out of the pose. But if you're feeling discomfort or if you're thinking about, you know, the pain that you're feeling, what I want you to do is instead imagine what it feels like when everything's working just as it should. Imagine how grateful you would be or will be when your back pain is gone. How much you can achieve when your body is in its perfect state of health, and offer up thanks in advance to the universe or God or whoever you believe in for restoring you to perfect and complete health. And anytime you find yourself focusing on the pain, refocus to the gratitude for perfect health that you will experience in the future. We're going to shift to the other leg, so I want you to just gently pull your leg off the chair. Get into this posture however it works for you. You may want to sit up and scoot your bottom over so that now your, in my case, right leg, but your other leg is on the floor and you have your other knee bent at a 90 degree angle. Up the chair. Noticing if this side feels any different at all to the other side. It might. A lot of times our back pain might be centered over one side versus the other. It might be associated with a hip issue or an injury, anything like that. Just notice again, as we notice things, not labeling it as good or bad. Really, nothing's good or bad. It's just how we perceive it that makes it so. But notice how it might be different. I also want you to notice if you feel any relief in any of the strain that you felt before. And know that as you have this leg up, when we return it to the floor, you're going to experience that same sense of relief on the opposite side. And again, looking forward to that. If at any point you find yourself overthinking, focus on your breath. You can focus on pulling your breath into your belly and expanding your belly. You can count and do square breathing where you breathe in for a count of four, hold it for a count of four, exhale for a count of four, and then hold it at the bottom. Whatever it takes for you to focus on your breath, or if you have music playing gently in the background, which is always nice, focus on those things. Chair underneath your calf. Relax in whatever way feels good to you. Just relax in your posture. It is an alternative posture if you ever do this practice again, to put both legs
up your chair. So, you know, you would just be centered and more like this. It does give you a little bit different strength or stretch, I mean. And I do think it's a little gentler to have one foot up and then the other. Another alternative, as I said, was really just scoot your bottom right up against a wall and put your legs up the wall. You can also do that with a bolster under your low back. So there's lots of ways to get into some of these postures and to get similar benefits. And this is just the one I've chosen today. Take a few last deep breaths in this posture and mentally prepare to transition to our next posture. This time, if you'd like to take your leg off of the chair, you can do so. I'm just going to push mine away with my feet because I can, and I don't need it anymore. You can do whatever you want with your chair. What we're going to set up for now is just a gentle open twist. And so for this, you're going to need two blankets that are folded lengthwise. Sorry, just straighten that up by the little toes blanket here. So two blankets stacked, eight fold lengthwise. And you're gonna lay those kind of on the upper third of your mat. And then you're gonna want another blanket that's folded into a square. A little bit lower for me. And you're gonna lie back onto these eight fold blankets so that they're kind of supporting your low back. Let me get my phone so I can keep track of how long we've been in here. So we're going to do that, and then bring your knees to, like, bend your knees and let them go over to one side or the other, and you're going to put your other square blanket in between your knees for support. And then open up your arms into a gentle twist. If this is too much, you can lay on a bolster, or you can just lay with this underneath your low back, but not necessarily twist. So do what feels good to your body, and again, nothing should feel strained. Nothing should feel painful. I mean, you should feel a nice, deep, gentle stretch. It's not going to feel like you're doing absolutely nothing, but it in no way should feel pinchy, sharp, anything like that. Those are bad pain. I mean, there's kind of like that nice, oh, this is like moving my body into a different way feel, and then there's the, you know, shooting pain signals to your brain and telling you to stop way. And if your brain is telling you to stop, then listen. My yoga teacher, training instructor, used to always say the body is innately intelligent, which means your body knows what your body needs. Your body knows what feels right, and so listen to your own body over what anyone else tells you to do. If your body says this stretch feels good, awesome. If your body says I need to do something else, then listen to your body and do what your body says. Acknowledge too that from day to day, our bodies are different, right? So there may be one day that I just don't think this feels very good. Maybe I slept wrong, or I don't know. It's just not happening today. And then there's other days where this feels good, or maybe something deeper than this feels good. So just know that from day to day, our bodies change, and we need to listen every day and honor every day. One side might be different than the other. That's totally normal. There's nothing wrong with you. If that's the case, and the other side, this doesn't feel good, then we won't do it on the other side, right? We'll do something different. So just always honor yourself. might be, if you have a lot of, you know, severe low back pain, this might be too much. If you have more upper back pain, this may feel like it's not doing as much for you. But feel, for me, like, kind of been having this, like, just pressure in between my shoulder blades. I'm not sure what from. Doesn't really matter, but I can feel, you know, the floor supporting me and pressing into that, almost as if, like, I have a masseuse, like, kind of pressing into my spine, and that really is providing some relief for me from that. The other thing I know I need to do is get on my yoga wheel, and, you know, that's something, you know, not everybody has, not everybody finds helpful or comfortable. But if you do have, like, kind of pain between your shoulder blades and you have access to a yoga wheel, I really love mine for kind of stretching that out, opening the heart, just kind of feeling, it's like a supported back bend, really. So instead of doing wheel pose, I might use my yoga wheel to support me in a wheel pose. And that's a really nice thing to have. And, you know, maybe in a future practice, I'll incorporate that into our restorative yoga, because I do think it plays a role, at least for some. We have a couple more minutes in this posture. One more minute, actually. And then we're going to switch, and we're going to go to the other side. And that should be a pretty smooth transition. I want you to just put one knee up, then the other, you can move your blanket, and sit for just a second in the neutral place where you're not twisted to either side, and let your body readjust to that feeling of the blankets just supporting you underneath your spine. And when you're ready, you can place the blanket back between your knees now, or you can do it, you know, when you're done, but let your knees fall right back over to the other side. Open up your arms, and again, notice if this posture feels any different on this side. For me, I have, like, kind of a spot along, like, lengthwise along my back that I can feel a different kind of tension in, so that's nice to know. It's working out those kind of paraspinal muscles in addition to the low back. In addition to, you know, a little bit of torsion or twist in your internal organs, I think one thing we forget when we, if you do a lot of yoga, or even if you're, you know, you don't do a lot of yoga, we think of yoga as a physical practice that is good for our muscles. Maybe that's what you think. But yoga is like this whole body experience, and the things that we do in yoga, the twists and things especially, are great for bringing out your organs, for improving your circulation. It's good for bone and joint health. Especially, you know, when we're doing vinyasa yoga, it's really good for kind of weight-bearing exercise. You're working your muscles, you're working everything. And then it also is designed to clear our mind and to be a spiritual practice by moving breath and energy through our body in a productive way. So yoga really is good for the emotional body, the spiritual body, the physical body. And when we talk about the physical body, it's all aspects of the physical body from the inside out. So just know that as you're in this posture, you're not just stretching your back, you're not just stretching across that hip, but you're also getting some nice kind of wringing out of those organs, clearing some toxins out as well. Good for our lungs, of course, as we breathe in through our nose and out through our nose. Just let yourself relax in this pose. If it feels good to you, you can turn your head to one side or the other. So sort of like one of my favorite ways to kind of end a vinyasa practice is with a spinal twist. I think it always feels kind of nice as a final posture. It's not our final posture today, but it's also kind of nice to have this different level of support underneath my back, underneath my, or between my knees here, creating some support. You may notice in a spinal twist that the lower lung you feel like a little more pressure on, right? Like as you expand, you can feel that lung against your rib cage more than the upper side of the twist. So maybe observe that for a minute in your mind. Just notice how your breath feels as it moves into your lungs. This posture is a little bit harder to get into that deep abdominal breathing, right? Because you're kind of stretched out a little bit more. See how low you can get the breath into your lungs. Take one more minute or so in this posture. Take a deep breath in. Release it. And then one knee at a time, bring your knees back up into that posture and push yourself up however's comfortable for you. So that's going to be different. No stress on your body as you do this. We're going to move our blankets out of the way for just a moment. And we're going to take our bolster or your blanket, your double roll blankets, whichever works for you. And we're going to come into a supported pigeon pose. So for a supported pigeon, you're going to have one foot that's kind of, if you're sitting on this heel with your knee bent, you're going to pull this bolster so that it's all the way up against your kind of pubic bone, I guess, and into your hip crease. You're going to then press that back leg back and let yourself lay over the bolster, giving yourself a nice deep stretch. And for this posture, if this is too much for you, and you'll know because you might feel pinching. A lot of people don't know this, but I had hip impingement that I've had fixed. And, you know, getting into postures like this would create a real pinch because I did not have the hip mobility that would be typical. I had, you know, my acetabulum was kind of overhung a little bit and the head of my femur wasn't round, and so you kind of end up with this pinching, it's impingement, right? So for me, if you have hip impingement or anything like that, I can tell you that coming up, you know, you could put your bolster just on blocks like you did for the child's pose. I've got them on top just because it's easier than moving the whole thing, but that's going to lessen the crease a lot in the depth of that posture. So whatever works for you, you can do, well, yeah, there's lots of postures you can do. I'm not going to go through all of them today. We'll try a different one next time. If this is like just really not accessible to you, go back to supported child's pose for a little bit, because it is a similar stretch. We're getting a little bit deeper into that kind of SI joint area and into the outer hip of the bent knee. And then the other thing that we're getting out of this is a little bit of a psoas stretch on the extended leg and a little bit of a, you know, kind of down that front side of that leg. But if it's too much, it's too much. Pigeon pose in vinyasa can be a really challenging hip opener. And I just always like to notice how different it feels when I have that bolster underneath me. And it's interesting, right? Because we often, if you practice vinyasa with me as well or with anybody else, I think sometimes we push our bodies a lot because we try to think of it as exercise. But a bolster is actually always accessible to you. A block under your hip is always accessible to you. And I just always kind of think, you know, if we didn't try to twist ourselves or push ourselves kind of beyond what our body really wants to do, for whatever reason, most likely, I mean, for me, I would call it ego, right? Like, oh, I can do this and I will. If we didn't do that, we might not find ourselves in these painful places in the first place. So, again, your body is innately intelligent. If your body tells you it's too deep when you're practicing vinyasa, do it differently.
You know, I do have one other way to practice pigeon if you don't like this. So I'll show you for the other side. If you want to go back and do it that way, if you were in child's pose, you can always pause the video when we switch out of this and do the other side. So before I go into pigeon pose, you guys can stay put or you can press yourself kind of back up and watch. Another way to do pigeon, half pigeon, is to put the bolster kind of under you in this way, right? So I'm sitting on the bolster and stretching that psoas. But you can see that compared to pigeon, if this bolster were not here, it's not nearly as deep and it's not nearly as intense. And then if I wanted to, I could just come down to my elbows. So that's another way to practice supported pigeon. We're going to go back to the way that I showed you on the first side, unless you really like that way better, yogi's choice. So got mini bent, pressing this into that hip crease, pubic bone, and then we're just going to fold it over the bolster, letting that right side settle in. You can turn your face to either side that feels good to you. So I may be a little bit muffled because I'm going to turn my head the other way just to balance things out for me. I just realized that my space heater is still on, so you may be able to hear the hum of that. My room gets super cold, and when I practice restorative yoga by myself, I actually do have a blanket on, and I usually dress pretty warmly. Today I was a little bit hot. I hiked earlier, but my room was still cold, and I was like, well, it can't be covered over, so I'm going to heat it up. And I forgot to turn it off, which I usually do before I start my video. Either way. Thing about this particular posture is it does kind of feel safe and supported on your heart, and we are going to do a bit of a heart opener for our next posture. I think it's always good to kind of get this, like, you know, pressure
opening sensation without being open before we progress to those moves. Nice thing about this is, I mean, if you get relaxed enough, you could just fall asleep. Nobody knows. We're just kind of all in our own homes, doing our own thing. Take a deep breath in and press yourself up. Maybe come to your hands and knees. That's probably the next easiest posture. And we're going to set ourselves up for heart pose. And there's going to be a couple of options here. If you are here for relaxation and you're not particularly prone to back pain, the one option would be to have your bolster right up against your sacrum, and then stretch your legs out and open yourself over your bolster. For those of you with back pain, it's a little bit easier to build a ramp with your blocks. So you'll kind of pull your bolster up. One block there, one block here, and then we will build a ramp. And then you have two options for your legs. I think, hang on, I'm gonna grab a towel here. I forgot to pull this in. Okay, so one option, so we're still gonna scoot our sacrum right up against that. And before we lean back, we're going to put our feet either in butterfly. And for butterfly, it's nice to just take a towel around the back and then wrap it so that your feet are kind of bound. Okay, so that's one option, is butterfly feet, heart pose. And then the other option is to put your feet, your knees, I suppose, over a bolster or a blanket roll. And that's gonna just, sorry, I'm off center. So that's gonna add a little support. That takes some pressure off your low back. So certainly if you have sciatica, you're gonna wanna do the bolster option. I'm gonna do butterfly legs just because that feels a little better to me today. But you do whatever feels best to you. And we're just gonna lie back and allow your arms to fall open to the side and your heart to shine open. I think it's nice in this posture to imagine that as we breathe in, our heart is expanding, breathing in gratitude. And as we breathe out, we can breathe out fear, worry, doubt, judgment, resentment, unforgiveness, anger, any negative emotion. And I always like to say, you know, emotions are just emotions, not really good or bad. But we don't really want to live in those emotions that take us below the line of authentic choice, right? So we breathe in faith and hope and trust and joy, peace, harmony, power, authentic power, where we're being our authentic selves. The longer you're here, the more your heart will open, the more your shoulders will melt back. Whole back line of your body is supported either by the bolster or by the floor. As we're in this posture and our arms are open, we're also opening our throat chakra a little bit. Supporting everything else. This is a great place to use an eye pillow if you have one. Interesting, like, yeah, sitting in these postures, I think, how often, if ever, do I sit and do the same thing for 3 to 5 minutes? And the answer for me is pretty much never. And so I think, you know, for a lot of us, we tend to become humans who are so busy doing, achieving, accomplishing, striving, whatever. We kind of forget that we're human beings and that we should just be sometimes. Be still. Be mindful. Just allow ourselves that stillness. But doing nothing, I mean, essentially right now, I'm doing nothing. That can bring, right? Not fidgeting, not moving around. Sometimes sitting alone with your thoughts can be really challenging. And I think it is a lot of meditation because it does kind of really allow me to practice that kind of act of releasing thoughts, letting them be passing things, not, you know, things to latch on to or obsess about or give more attention than what they really should take. When you're ready, we're just going to open ourselves or sit ourselves back up. We're going to do butterfly in a different way. And the easiest thing to do right here is just turn our bodies towards your bolster. And we're going to scoot up so that the bolster is, again, right as close to the pubic bone as possible. It's going to be closer, really more on your inner thighs for this. And then we're going to just lie ourselves down across the bolster, letting our arms drape down by our sides. So a lot of this is just kind of like stretch and counter stretch, stretch and counter stretch. Breathe in. You can straighten your legs out if that feels good to you. You don't have to have them in a butterfly position. I personally prefer the butterfly position. I find it easier on me than, you know, the opposite option. Like a slightly different posture than our child's pose here. You can also make your ramp higher by stacking your blocks. I find this to be a little more stable. And again, you can always stack bolster on top of bolster to kind of rig. So if you wanted to be more like this, right, I could put another bolster here. So I really think, and honestly that feels really nice to me right now, so I'm gonna keep it like this. The biggest key with restorative yoga is to get your props in the place where you truly feel supported.
one thing that that happens kind of frequently during yoga, Reiki, massage, any kind of energy healing modality at all that you might practice is sometimes people have like a really significant emotional release. And I don't think we often talk about it. And so if you feel like in this particular practice, or if ever you're practicing and you do feel like that, you know, flood of emotion that just, you can't stop it and it's coming out, support a child's pose or this posture or something where your heart feels really supported is a great posture to get into. I would probably put a client in support a child's pose more than this, because you are kind of closer to the ground and can hug the bolster a little bit easier than this one. But this is an option as well. And then just really allowing any emotion that needs to come out to flow. It's totally normal, it's healthy. A lot of times we end up with low back pain, high back pain, pain in general, because we do, our body does store and trap and host past traumas and hurt. And it can be something that we hold on to for a really long time, to the point where it becomes, you know, dysfunctional in our body. Dis-ease becomes disease, right? So when you're not at ease, when things are not sitting right with you, if you hold on to that and you don't release it and you don't have a way to let that flow through, it can cause actual health problems. And we know that to be true. The connection between the mind and the body is very strong. So if you're in a practice like this and you have an emotional release, that's a really good thing, because it is letting that emotion out before it becomes physical illness, or potentially maybe it already has, but it's working its way out. So just know that at any point, if you have that experience, it's normal, and it's just something that happens sometimes. I did not prompt you to do so. This is obviously a posture where you need to turn your head potentially. So if you haven't done so, do it for the last minute or so, just to stretch out the other side of your neck. Send a breath to your low back. For Savasana, you can take any posture that you enjoy. If you do a lot of restorative yoga, you may have some favorites. You can take sideline pose if that feels good to you. You can Shavasana in a supported child's pose if you like. I'm going to use just like a standard basic relaxation pose. So I'm going to take my eightfold blanket. I'm just going to make a blanket roll. And that's going to go where my feet or ankles are. to have a bolster where my knees are. So I'm kind of, you know, get this to where we're at. And then underneath my head, you can use a pillow or you can create another kind of neck roll. Kind of depends on what you like. A lot of times, I mean, really what you want, sort of like right way to do this really, is for your body to be totally relaxed. So whatever that looks like to you. All right. So I'm just going to hold this up a little more. There we go. All right. And if you feel like, you know, you need a thicker neck roll or your ankle roll's not quite right, just adjust it. But at this time, and if you want to do side lying pose and you're comfortable with that posture, please do take it. I'll prompt you after a couple of minutes to move to the other side. But for those of you doing the basic relaxation pose, I guess for all of you, I want you to just take a deep breath in. Release everything to your mat. Shouldn't have built too much tension. Shouldn't have built any tension in your body during this particular practice, but it's good to just kind of consciously relax your body, feeling it melt into the mat. This practice is probably going to tap out at right around an hour. One thing that I think is important to note is you may only have 30 minutes, and I mean, at any point in time, you can pick, you know, a couple of these postures. You could pick one of these postures and spend 10 minutes in it and get a ton of benefit from that posture. So don't always feel like you have to commit to an entire practice or an entire hour. And the same is true of meditation, right? Like 5 to 15 minutes of meditation is really beneficial. It doesn't have to be an hour at a time or hours, or, you know, these, like, we don't have to all become monks where we practice meditation as a lifestyle, but you get to the point where, you know, if you can meditate for 15 minutes and then 30 minutes and you have long meditation days, you have days where it's, you really just do some breathing for a little bit, you get to the point where you can pull yourself into that relaxed state a lot more easily in your everyday life during times of stress. And to me, that's really the benefit of meditation and yoga, is, you know, learning to control your thoughts, learning to let them go and release them, letting go of old thought patterns, and kind of putting that to practice in your everyday life. When things get stressful, can you breathe through it? Can you release the story you're telling yourself before you overreact? And that, to me, is the true practice of meditation and mindfulness, really. If you are in sideline pose, I want you to take one more big breath in through your nose. Sigh it out. And press yourself up and set yourself up to switch to the opposite side. And as we lay here for our last few moments of Savasana, I want you to just imagine, you know, we went to this hill at the beginning. Imagine you're at the bottom of the hill that you climbed and came back down unburdened. And now you notice that at the bottom of this hill, flowing down from the top, is a stream.
clear, deep. You can see all the way to the bottom. And maybe kneel beside the stream. And you can see a reflection. You can see the bottom of the stream. You can see little frogs and tadpoles and things swimming in the stream as well. And you imagine that all the burdens that you had put in your backpack and carried up that hill have been released into the stream, and they flow by, and you see them, and you see them coming. You release any emotion attached to that, and as you breathe out, you notice them kind of whisk by you in this fast-moving stream. And the stream carries them farther and farther and farther away until they're completely out of sight. Eventually, as all water does, they will return to the ocean, where those burdens become incredibly small in the vastness of the ocean. And the tide pulls them farther and farther away until they're completely gone. And all that's left is you looking in a nice, clear, unpolluted stream, knowing at any time that you have a thought about any of those things you released or any new things that might come up, you can return to this stream at any time. You don't even have to climb to the top of the mountain. You can come to the base and you can place those thoughts, worries, fears into the stream and watch them be swept away, even if only in your mind. Maybe you focus in on the sound of the water kind of cascading over the rocks and pebbles, kind of this babbling stream that goes by, and the sound of that water coming by clears any remaining thoughts. There's any debris from your mind and any thoughts you had you can't really latch onto because it just kept getting swept away. And as we conclude our practice today, you can get out from the water, you can stay here if you'd like. But you know you can always come back here. And you walk home, or you walk to your car and you drive home, knowing that you left a lot of things on that mountain and in that stream that you didn't need anymore. And you go home feeling lighter, more joyful, and less burdened. Take a deep breath in, sigh it out. Begin to bring movement to your fingers and toes. Maybe bend your knees, maybe hug them into your chest. And then come to a comfortable seated position. You can keep your eyes closed. You can open them if you'd like. Bring your hands to heart center. The light in me sees and honors the light in you. Namaste. Thank you everybody for joining me. If you enjoyed this practice, please like it, share it with anybody else who you think might benefit from the practice. And always feel free to drop a comment, or if I know you personally, send a message and let me know what you would like to see and what would help you on your journey. Have a great day. Love you all. See you soon.